So that EDA, it's just so deeply ingrained in the fabric of the industry. It's not going to be easily uprooted. And then you tack on something like design IP and patents. Synopsys and Cadence have really, really deep hooks in the semiconductor industry.
Hey everyone, welcome back to Chipstock Investor. Hope you're having a great week. We are just exiting one of our favorite seasons, allergy season, and now we're headed into mosquito season.
The only season you dislike more than allergy season.
Exactly. Absolutely. So if you start seeing mosquito bites pop up on us, you'll know why. In other news, the Mavs are one game away from headed to the NBA Finals, so we are very excited about that.
Yeah, and speaking of, if you're an NBA fan, we should plug our Semiconductor Insider at $5 a month. It is a lot less than NBA Season Pass. A lot less entertaining, though, as well.
Our Semiconductor Insider membership gets you all of our show notes, video notes, published manuals, and access to our Discord channel. Check that out in the description below. If you are not interested in Discord, sign up on Ko-fi for the membership and you can get all of our manuals available to download from there. Okay, but for real, the reason we're here is to talk about Synopsys today, one of the main players in the EDA space in the semiconductor industry flow.
Yes, in fact, it is the leader in electronic design automation software or EDA software, also a leader in intellectual property and patents. So this is absolutely foundational to the industry, and EDA and patents harbor that very, very critical choke point in the industry where software completes the virtuous cycle and flows back into the top of the development flow for semiconductors. Let's break down that space a little bit more. Synopsys and Cadence are far and away the top two leaders in EDA software. Mentor, now a small segment of Siemens, the German industrial conglomerate. There's been big news in this space so far in 2024. Back in January, Synopsys announced the mega merger with Ansys. That is still ongoing. It looks like regulators in China have flagged that for review. We'll see what happens. Cadence, in our prior videos, we've talked about how they've made some big upgrades to their computing platform. And if you look at the bottom, there's that small company based out of Australia called Altium, a leader in printed circuit board design and layouts. It's being acquired by the large integrated device manufacturer Renesas in Japan. Casey and I discussed this in depth and how the EDA market is undergoing a bit of consolidation, but very much remaining a very key foundational part of the semiconductor industry back in March. Catch that video here. But let's pivot back to the core EDA software, Casey, because the integration with Ansys, if that goes through, maybe I should say whether or not it goes through, is really broadening the use case of EDA beyond just the historical use case of semiconductors.
Yes, EDA chip and electronic system design are absolutely foundational to this multi-trillion dollar electronics industry. And when you think about it, there isn't much in our life or in the economy that doesn't have some sort of electronic component anymore. Taking a look at the global value chain for EDA and IP, it's a huge market, a $17.5 billion value in 2023, all the way up to electronic systems, nearly $2 trillion in value for 2023. That number is only going up. Nick, we did a video recently on the data center cooling company Vertiv. During that video, our conclusion after putting it through the framework was it's a great company, but it's not something that we're going to be investing in at this point. Why is it easier to pass on Vertiv for us?
Yeah, ultimately it came down to valuation in that last video review that we did. But really, if you back it up to the overall industry, like you just explained, Casey, Synopsys and Cadence Design, both of which we started accumulating late in 2022, encompass power delivery and cooling systems for data centers. So again, it's not just semiconductor design anymore. Synopsys is a critical piece of software. If you're designing an entire data center and all parts, integrating all the parts and pieces and equipment needed to build these very large, very complex computing systems, Synopsys is there. You need that software. So ultimately, we're not invested directly in a company like Vertiv, but it became an easier decision to pass based on current valuation because we already have exposure to that market via a company like Synopsys.
Yes, that makes absolute sense. Synopsys and companies like it, Cadence Design Systems or Siemens, which purchased Mentor Graphics, and now eventually Renesas once the Altium acquisition is complete, as well as Keysight Technologies. All of these companies are at the heart of things like chiplets, heterogeneous integration, and advanced packaging, because multi-die systems have definitely become more and more crucial to making smaller and smaller and more power efficient chips.
Absolutely. So it's interesting that you can actually find an end-to-end investment that covers, you know, the whole spectrum, everything from the small chiplets themselves all the way up to the full system integration. For example, data centers, automotive, another critical design market where you're trying to figure out how to deliver power efficiently to all of these different chips and the mechanical parts that intersect with them, you end up with a very, very powerful software business that is a rarity in that we often say there are not actually that many defensible moats in the technology industry, but we believe that companies like Synopsys and Cadence are one of those exceptions where they do indeed actually have a very, very difficult to uproot place in the industry flow.
When many investors think about chip design, they possibly think about ARM holding, because ARM holding has had a lot of media coverage, especially with its design IP for Apple. But Synopsys is actually the second largest IP provider worldwide, which is another reason why we've felt it's completely okay that we've passed on ARM holding.
Yeah, that's right. And another reason Synopsys is so competitive, it's not just the design software, it's not just the IP that gets used when designing the chips, it's both in one package. And as you said, Casey, ARM, of course, gets lots of media coverage because of the very, very efficient Apple silicon, especially the MacBook. We're now on the M3, really, really powerful, game-changing chips when those were released a number of years ago. Qualcomm, of course, getting in the ARM-based laptop race as well with the Snapdragon X Elite. NVIDIA putting ARM CPUs to use in its data center AI systems. And so ARM gets all the attention, but it's interesting that Synopsys often gets overlooked. It maybe doesn't have those really ultra-efficient CPU cores, but look at the breadth and depth of the IP portfolio here. It, of course, has a bit in those logic cores, plays a space there, but also the interconnect portfolio to make sure that data is moving around in an application, let's say an AI system, making sure data is moving around efficiently, making sure that the data is being secured properly. So let's maybe just compare the IP revenue here, just for the sake of comparison. We'll come back to this pie chart that you made, Casey, here momentarily when we talk about the financials a bit more. But just in their last reported quarter, Q2 of fiscal year 2024, $400 million in design IP. That's actually not really that far behind ARM. It's not like a distant second place to ARM holding.
You can see that the license and other revenue from ARM holding, $414 million. And that royalty revenue, $514 million, that's when ARM gets a small kickback from the royalty fee when a device that has an ARM chip running in it is sold. Synopsys, the second behind ARM in this design IP, not far at all in revenue.
And we're going to call ARM and Synopsys different because technically, if you want to look at it, Qualcomm is a big leader in IP licensing and royalties. They have that big QTL, Qualcomm Technology Licensing segment, but this is almost entirely mobile communications patents that Qualcomm monetizes here. So you think 4G and 5G networks, data that's able to move across radio waves, whenever a device makes use of that, there's a high likelihood that the company is paying Qualcomm for the usage of that patent license. So $1.3 billion for Qualcomm, but that's entirely different from what we're talking about here with Arm and Synopsys, where we're talking about more logic and networking chip technologies.
Let's talk about some of the financials for Synopsys, and we'll show you their revenue guidance for this fiscal year, 2024. They expect a growth rate of between 14.5% to 15.6%, revenue in the range of just over $6 billion to $6.15 billion. This growth rate for Synopsys ends up being usually in the mid-teens percentage yearly, and that roughly follows what the semiconductor industry spends in the research and development portion of the business, usually also at a mid-teens percentage growth. Here's the recent revenue scorecard for Synopsys. You can see that they have been meeting or exceeding their guidance over the last several quarters. This most recent quarter, Q2 of 2024, just over $1.4 billion in revenue.
And as far as the broad-based revenue segments, we already talked about the design IP, the actual patent portfolio that Synopsys owns and gets revenue from when its customers integrate those designs into their chips and systems. The core business still very much in growth mode, though. EDA, just over $1 billion in the last quarter. And again, growing at a low to mid-teens percentage growth rate, because this is so tightly integrated with the research and development process for semiconductors. It spans the software itself, but Synopsys and Cadence as well, both provide hardware, test and verification systems. So once you make the design, before you send that onto the chip fab, let's say someone like Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing or Global Foundries, before you send that off to the fab, which can be a very costly process, you want to make sure that chip design is going to work properly. So you get this test and verification kit. Oftentimes it's an FPGA, a field programmable gate array based unit. And then you custom program that FPGA to the specifications that you've just designed with Synopsys software. You run it through a series of tests to make sure it's operating the way you intended it to. And then it goes on to the fab floor, where again, Synopsys software integrates with the fab equipment and fab software that those companies are running. So that EDA, it's just so deeply ingrained in the fabric of the industry. It's not going to be easily uprooted. And then you tack on something like design IP and patents. Synopsys and Cadence have really, really deep hooks in the semiconductor industry and get that consistent low teens percentage growth over time as a result.
Synopsys revenue tends to be very stable, but the cyclicality comes in with the profit margin side. You can see that the free cash flow has fallen a bit this year. And Nick, maybe you can explain a little bit more about why that is.
Yeah, you can see, obviously, the first half of the year, free cash flow is pretty meager, not so good. It is expected to rebound the second half of the year. A lot of this just tends to be timing of when they renew their long-term agreements with customers. And that tends to skew towards the second half of every fiscal year. And then there's also timing of revenue, especially with the hardware side of the business as well. And then also because it's manufacturing based, we go through these cycles where Synopsys will realize revenue and thus profit, especially on a free cash flow metric, based on when their customers' projects ramp up to full production. So second half of the year, we are expected to get a nice little rebound in free cash flow margins. Roughly $1.1 billion is the guidance in dollar terms. But as Synopsys continues to mature along with the industry, and then also factoring in that Ansys acquisition a bit, They announced that they were selling the Software Integrity Group, which we have covered in previous videos. That's going away. Ansys now coming into play. Long term, there's certainly a lot of upside for Synopsys if they can get those operating margins out of the high 30% range on an adjusted basis up into the mid 40% range. And then on a free cash flow basis, obviously for fiscal 2024, expected to be a down year for free cash flow, but even at a pretty decent year, 20%, 25% historically, the free cash flow margin profile for Synopsys, they're looking at a low to mid 30% over the next, let's say, 3 to 5 years. So not just a growth story, as the business matures, we should see fantastic profit margin expansion along the way as well, which is exactly what we would expect from a tightly integrated hardware and software business like Synopsys.
Synopsys has traded at a premium for as long as we've been covering it. And currently the shares are right around $588, 89 billion market cap. I would not call this a value stock. Let's talk about the expectations that the market has to get us to that $588 per share using our reverse DCF calculation.
We're taking a blended per share profit of $8.18, and that's just taking the trailing 12-month earnings per share on a GAAP basis, averaged with the free cash flow per share over the last 12 months. And to get us to fair value at this particular stock price, we think the market is basically expecting about 30% growth on a per share basis for the next 5 years, and then a 6 to 7% terminal growth rate thereafter. Discount rate of 10%, that gets us to approximately $580, $590, $600 per share as a fair value. This is definitely not a low bar for Synopsys to clear. But as you stated, Casey, this thing has really never traded for a value, not for as long as we've covered it for the last 3-4 years. And when we finally started buying it, that was via a dollar cost average plan along with Cadence starting in late 2022. It was with this expectation that this thing's never going to just be cheap. It's going to grow into the valuation over time. And as long as the semiconductor industry is this hotly followed secular growth trend, companies like Synopsys and Cadence are probably going to trade for a premium. And even more so, considering the fact that they're so foundational to the whole industry. There's just no getting around using software platforms like Synopsys and Cadence if you want to design chips, and also increasingly the entire systems that utilize electronic parts and components.
Last year in 2023, we were dollar cost averaging into both Cadence Design Systems and Synopsys. We put a hold on our DCA at the beginning of this year in 2024. We like where we're at, but would really like these stocks to become a bigger portion of our portfolio. And so we're thinking that we're going to continue to nibble throughout this year whenever we see a dip in stock price for either Synopsys or Cadence Design. As we've covered, these stocks are not what you would say cheap, but they are certainly foundational businesses that we want in our portfolio.
And maybe I'd just add, one of the reasons why they're no longer a DCA, it's not just because of the valuation getting a little bit stretched beyond what we're comfortable with, but also because of the DCA plus the stock, both stock prices increasing so much last year. Synopsys and Cadence now collectively, we consider them kind of as like two parts of one position in our portfolio at about 2.5%, maybe a bit more than 2.5% of our portfolio. So that's kind of reaching the point where we no longer feel personally the need to DCA, but rather instead just nibble opportunistically.
All right. Thanks for watching this episode on Synopsys. Make sure you hit the subscribe button. That's a free and easy way to support us here at Chipstock Investor, and we really appreciate it. And again, if you're interested in our video notes, show notes, Discord membership, check out the link below. We have that membership available on Ko-fi or here on YouTube. We will see you all again soon at Chipstock Investor.